Nuclear power stations. Have I got a view, you sir? If you have read the National Miner, you will have known that Arthur Scargill had a view long before last night's ITV programme, long before all the anti-nuclear groups. I was campaigning against nuclear power stations in all forms. I was the one who gave evidence at Windscale against it. And I remember clearly when I went up to give evidence. I was on the witness stand 7 hours. When I came out, there was a spontaneous demonstration by the workers at Windscale against me for daring to speak against nuclear power. A spontaneous demonstration that had only taken 2 months to organise. And the press, television and radio were there in force. 60 press and television cameras were there. All recorded this massive protest against Scargill's opposition to nuclear fuel. And they put one lad up, he says, "You know, Mr. Scargill," he says, "nuclear power's very safe, man. It's grand. I used to work at the pit," he says. "And when I finished at the pit, I came to work at Windscale, man. And they're really good to us, management," he says. And they're all filming him, writing. I says, "I'll tell you what they do, Arthur." He says, "When I get contaminated, they take me away." And at that moment, every television camera ran out of film. And every scribe's pencil broke. Not a word. And I'll tell you who paid for the demonstration. British Nuclear Fuels. I'll tell you something about nuclear power. I've debated it from Land's End to John O'Groats, and I've spoken here about it. I've been speaking about this as the president of the anti-nuclear campaign in Britain. I don't know how many people knew that. If you read the money, you would. The worst accident that can happen in a nuclear station. Do you know how many it would kill? It would kill 1 million people who have no connection with a power plant. If you contrast that with the worst accident in mining, that would only kill 400. Nuclear waste. In the sea, around our coasts, the radiation level tonight as I speak is 50 times higher than the radiation level in the United States Pacific testing grounds. It's little wonder that we've got an incidence of cancer 10 times the national average. It's not confined to Windscale or Seascale. All the towns from Windscale down to Lancashire have been affected. There was a major accident at Windscale in 1957 and it was hushed up. There was a major emission that was measured at the North Pole, and thousands of gallons of milk had to be destroyed and cattle killed because of the contamination. The tragedy was that the contamination in the milk was not tackled until 3 days after the incident. And so for 3 days, kids in the Lancashire and Cumbria towns were drinking milk that was contaminated by the Windscale emission in 1957. We're trundling nuclear waste around Britain today in trainloads. But of course it's safe, no problems. We decided to test out the safety aspect. Three of my colleagues, last November, on a Friday night, went to a London railway station carrying a rocket launcher. Nothing peculiar about that. Everybody in Doncaster and London carries rocket launchers. They went onto the station. They got 3 platform tickets before the increase in pay. They went down the platform and into the sidings. They painted on the side of the wagon the word "bang." When we asked British Nuclear Fuels what would have happened if we'd have fired a rocket into the unguarded train load of nuclear waste, they said it would have created a problem. It would have contaminated their bit, a square mile of London, for 50,000 years and killed 10,000 people. But I think the comments of the British Railways Board spokesman are worth repeating. When we asked it how it was was possible for three people on a Friday night at midnight carrying a rocket launcher to go down the platform into the sidings and paint the word BANG on the side of a train load of nuclear waste, he said, provided they had a platform ticket, they were entitled to be there. And of course, nuclear power produces an ingredient called plutonium. One piece of plutonium the size of that, equally distributed, will kill every man, woman and child in Britain today. I debated in Cornwall, the heartland of socialism, on the question of nuclear power. And I explained to this audience the terrible consequences of planning a nuclear program, the safety problems, and the deaths that would follow in its wake from plutonium, the ingredient of an atomic bomb. When I finished, we got a nuclear physicist, a professor in a white coat, just like those blokes in the front of the Daily Mirror that carted my waxwork figure. And he said, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Scargill has terrified you with his comments about plutonium. He really does talk incredibly naively. He said, I happen to have brought with me a piece of plutonium. It's clean, it's safe, and it's easy to handle. And I suggest, ladies and gentlemen, that this clean piece of plutonium, with no problems, that he put his Geiger counter to it, no radiation, hermetically sealed, is the fuel upon which you should place your future. Put it down. He said, I've also brought with me a piece of coal. Do forgive me, he said. And he put a pair of white gloves on. And he picked up this piece of coal that was wet. He said, I'm terribly sorry about this. It's rather dirty and obnoxious. It's very, very difficult to handle, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, dear. Oh, my goodness. Yes. Look, you can see the problem with it. Oh, goodness me. And he got his Geiger counter in. There was a bit of radiation because there's radiation in all rocks and all stones. He said, ladies and gentlemen, I leave the decision to you. Mr. Scargill would have you place your entire future on this dirty, obnoxious, harmful, and difficult to handle piece of coal. On the other hand, he said, I would have you place your future on this perfectly safe, clean, and easy to handle piece of plutonium. And he sat down. The audience looked as baffled as you do at the moment. And I got up to reply and I said, I think the demonstration by the professor was only exceeded by his theatrics. I said, could he, in the interest of fairness, take the demonstration one step further? I said, I worked down a pit on the coal face for 19 and a half years. And apart from heartache, I suffered from what we know in Yorkshire as heartburn. Or if you live in the posh south, acidity. I said, because we haven't got a Co-op or Boots chemist shop around the corner, the only way I could relieve my acidity was to suck a piece of coal. So I'll tell you what I'll do. I said, I'm willing to test the theory. I'm prepared to eat that dangerous, obnoxious piece of coal on one condition, that he's prepared to eat that safe, clean and easy to handle piece of plutonium. He lost his appetite instantly. Of course he did. Because nuclear power represents a threat. Not merely to miners. It represents a threat to mankind. And anybody with a degree of intelligence should be in the forefront of the campaign to stop nuclear power. I'm proud to say that my unit is. And I was the person who moved the resolution committing this union to a program of anti-nuclear campaigning. And I hope that this audience, having taken cognizance, not only of what I've said, but of the facts that came out this week and which will continue to emerge, support the campaign of the again, you am. We shall be giving evidence at Sizewell against the pressure water reactor, the one that was responsible for Three Mile Island. And I hope that you'll all join with us against nuclear power.